On the evening of July 18th, a critical zero-day attack chain was discovered being actively exploited against Microsoft SharePoint servers. This flaw allows unauthenticated attackers to gain full remote code execution using a single malicious request, and it affects thousands of on-prem deployments that haven't yet been patched. It's one of the worst SharePoint vulnerabilities we've seen in years. The reason this video took so long to record is I spent the last few days fighting with SharePoint's cursed setup process to get a working 2019 install running, just so I could demo the exploit myself. Let's dive into how bad this is, how it was discovered, and what you can do to protect your SharePoint servers, if you still have them. Okay, so to give some context on how bad this is an article from bleepingcomputer.com. US Nuclear Weapons Agency hacked in Microsoft SharePoint attacks. Unknown threat actors have breached the National Nuclear Security Administration's network in attacks exploiting a recently patched Microsoft SharePoint zero-day vulnerability chain. Yeah, so that's how bad this is. Hackers have access to a US government agency that controls nuclear security. So yeah, that's fun. But how did this all go down? Well, let's go to the customer guidance for SharePoint vulnerability CVE-2025-53770. Now, there are actually two CVEs. So originally, this exploit was just given this CVE. Because it's an exploit chain, right? It's an attack chain. This is actually two exploits. And so now what's happened is they've separated them. So we now have this 53770 and we have 53771. This attack is a combination of both. So it doesn't work with just one or the other. It has to be a combination of both of these. And you'll see why shortly. But this was a summary document put out by Microsoft. So Microsoft's aware of active attacks targeting on-prem SharePoint servers. This is important, by the way. It's only on-prem. So SharePoint Online is not affected, right? I think it says it here. Yeah, SharePoint Online in Microsoft 365 is not impacted. Now, apparently, there are quite a few on-prem SharePoint servers still out there. So this is bad. Microsoft has released security updates that fully protect customers using all supported versions of SharePoint affected by these two vulnerabilities. And customers should apply these updates immediately to ensure they're protected. So the good news is that there are patches for this. That's the good news. The bad news is there's just still a lot of servers out there. And I imagine a few customers who aren't aware that they're running on-prem servers that are internet-facing. It happens. So I imagine this attack might go around for a while. And there's some documentation on how to protect your environment. I will leave all these links, by the way, in the video description if you need them. So going into some of these vulnerabilities, so CVE-2025-53770. So this was the original CVE that was assigned to the entire attack chain. Now it's just this remote code execution vulnerability. All right, it's a CVSS of 9.8. So very bad, critical rated. It's a deserialization of untrusted data. And we'll go into that a little bit later of what this exactly means and how this is bad. But yeah, deserialization attacks, I wouldn't say that common, but they can be absolutely devastating if you do have them. And they're especially devastating in certain programming languages. .NET is one of them, Python, Java, those kind of languages. It's quite easy to get from a regular deserialization to remote code execution. So yeah, that's why this is so bad. The second vulnerability, CVE-2025-53771, is a server spoofing vulnerability. So it's an authentication bypass. So this attack works because it's targeting an authenticated page. The page it targets on the SharePoint server should only be accessible to certain logged in users. However, this CVE-53771 vulnerability allows you to access that page completely unauthenticated. And this has been given a 6.5, which I believe is still high. But yeah, this is bad. And this is actually kind of, honestly, the more crazy part of this attack, I think. This authentication bypass is really strange. Like deserialization attacks, again, quite well understood. You can protect against them relatively easily, actually, but this authentication bypass is just odd. But before we go into how it all works, let's talk about how it was discovered. And this is the blog that was released by i.security, who I believe, or at least they are claiming, to be the company, the organization that first discovered this. SharePoint Zero Day Uncovered, they're only using the first CVE. I'm not entirely sure why. So the blog explains on the evening of July 18th, they were the first in identifying large-scale exploitation of a new SharePoint remote code execution RCE vulnerability chain in the wild. They say it was demonstrated just days before on X. I believe that was just a screenshot, because this exploit chain was really a modification of an exploit chain that was discovered and disclosed to Microsoft at Pwn2Own Berlin earlier this year. That was patched. The patches weren't good enough. And I believe what happened was attackers got hold of the patches. They reverse engineered them, figured out what the exploit was, and came up with bypasses for both the patches. The new chain we uncovered in this blog was later named the CVEs, right? So these two CVEs by Microsoft. Before this vulnerability was widely known last Friday, our team scanned over 23,000 SharePoint servers worldwide. So there are a lot of SharePoint servers. In total, we discovered more than 400 systems actively compromised during four confirmed waves of attack. There's some patch information here. We're going to go down. And then here we go, the evening of July 18th. So early in the evening, their 24/7 detection team received an alert from one of their CrowdStrike Falcon EDR deployments at a specific customer. The alert flagged a suspicious process chain on a legacy SharePoint on-prem server tied to a recently uploaded malicious .aspx file. At first glance, it looked familiar. Classic web shell obfuscated code and a custom path designed to allow remote command execution via HTTP. We've seen these many times before. What made this one stand out was how it got there. So they first hypothesized that this was just a brute force attack, right? If you can get hold of an account with credentials, right, like an admin account, then you can do all sorts of fun stuff on a SharePoint server. However, they looked at the IIS logs and they noticed that the referrer was set to /layout/signout.aspx. So an authenticated request happened just after apparently the user logged out, right? So refer a header, remember, is a header that is effectively, hey, that page you were on before you went to another page, before you were redirected. And so what this is saying is they signed out and then they visited this page and uploaded a dangerous ASPX file, which makes no sense. They also found no successful authentications in the ADFS logs. So you have this post request to toolpane.aspx. The referrer was set to sign out, so they shouldn't have been authenticated, but they apparently managed to carry out some kind of authenticated attack. And tool shell, this is the attack chain that was discovered at Pwn2Own Berlin, right? So these two CVEs, 49706 and 49704, this was the attack chain, very, very similar to what happened. And obviously, this was patched by Microsoft, but apparently the patches weren't good enough. And so what seems to be happening is, for whatever reason, there's some code in SharePoint. And you got to remember, SharePoint is closed source, right? Nobody really knows the actual source code of SharePoint. So there's some code in SharePoint which checks for the referrer header. And for whatever reason, if it's set to /layout/signout.aspx, there's some assumption made on the server that that means the user just came from or was authenticated and therefore they should still be authenticated. It's really odd. Again, this is all just guesswork right now because we don't have access to the source code. But for some reason, setting this referrer header to the signout page tricked SharePoint into thinking the user was still authenticated. I guess the logic is you wouldn't be on the signout page if you were unauthenticated. I don't know. But yeah, this is crazy. So this is why I say the authentication bypass is honestly the weirdest thing about this. Deserialization attacks in .NET applications, I wouldn't say they're common, but they definitely happen. This kind of bypass is crazy. And so, yeah, you could access effectively any page, I believe. I'm not 100% sure on that, but I believe you could access technically any page using this authentication bypass. But the attackers access toolpane.aspx. And this is important. This blog doesn't actually go into why they targeted toolpane.aspx, because this is just covering the actual attack, right? This is the attack they discovered. And the attack they discovered uploaded a shell, so another ASPX file, which they then use to carry out attacks, okay? And yeah, there's various stuff about getting RCE on SharePoint using WISO Serial, which is a very common tool for generating deserialized payloads. This blog doesn't actually, I believe, at least the last time I read it, doesn't actually go into details about how the deserialization works. There is, though, luckily, an exploit module for Metasploit. Now, it's a pull request, so it's not officially a Metasploit. You can't just fire up Metasploit, find like this tool pane SharePoint module and exploit it. But you can download it from the pull request and you can install it yourself into Metasploit. And that's what I did, and that's what I'll show you in a second. But it's useful to go over this attack chain. So the header we've gone over, right? The authentication bypass we've gone over, it's just a referrer header that sort of, for some reason, bypasses that authentication. It means we can access pages which we should only be able to access when logged in. So here is the code for the Metasploit module. And so we have this gadget chain. They reconstructed it from a proof of concept that was posted here. It's thought to be the zero-day exploit caught in the wild. And that one uploaded a file. And this one, it's a little more, it's been made simpler, right? So you can actually create a Metasploit payload and execute that, right? So I think Meterpreter is the default. But toolpane.aspx in SharePoint is a page used for page editing and web part management. So a toolpane is something that appears when editing a SharePoint page to add or configure web parts. And the web parts use XML, right? So they're an XML configuration. And within that, you can put this gzip compressed base64 encoded .NET object payload. That part of the request is deserialized on the server side without being checked, right? It was just going to deserialize whatever the attacker gave it, which is obviously bad. And you could use ysoserial.net to generate a gadget chain that's basically a serialized payload, which when it's deserialized, will load specific classes and execute commands on the server. And that's effectively what this does. So you have this XML schema here, and then you have this diffgram, and diffgram is where the serialized payload is going to be placed. It's going to be placed right here. And yeah, if we scroll down, create gadget chain, depending on version of SharePoint, different gadgets can be used. So for the SharePoint Server 2019, a type confused delegate and a binary formatted gadget chain was tested. There's also a type confused delegate plus loss formatted gadget chain. So these gadget chains are very, very common with deserialization attacks, because generally speaking, you can't just serialize any kind of data and expect it to get remote code execution. You have to sort of chain a bunch of gadgets together in such a way that the deserialization process starts calling various functions and passing data. And it's that data and those functions that the gadget chains use to actually cause remote code execution. But yeah, so we base64 encode it, and then we wrap it. I believe there's, I forget where the gzip happens. There is a gzip component at some point. Here we go. Yeah, send exploit. So it's all gzipped at the end. It's literally a one request exploit. So it's a post request to toolpane.aspx, and then the referrer includes this signout.aspx path. And yeah, that's pretty much it. It uses these two. You just need two post parameters. You don't need any kind of view state. So there's no view state required. It doesn't even validate a view state or anything, which is obviously common in ASPX applications. This one just doesn't need it. And I'm not entirely sure why. It might be because of this signout.aspx, the authentication bypass. I'm not honestly sure. But for whatever reason, it just starts deserializing the data without validating anything. And that's super dangerous. Okay, so we have this Metasploit module loaded in Metasploit. I've configured, this is my Kali box, and this is the Windows Server 2019. It has SharePoint running on it. Our host set to this. It's running on port 80. I couldn't be bothered to set up SSL. Yeah, I'm just proxying it through burp because I liked observing the request, but you don't need to do that at all. And yeah, if I just type exploit, it is going to start exploiting it. So it's sending the stage. We get Meterpreter session 5 opened. And if I migrate to a process, I think I had 3948. If I migrate to this process, I should be able to spawn calc because I can't spawn calc without migrating first. So if I execute -f calc, there we go. We get the calculator spawning just to prove that I do have technically a Meterpreter shell running on this Windows Server 2019. So yeah, and if we go to burp suite, yep, this is the request. So you ignore the error page. It's literally just this request. So it's one request. It posts to toolpane.spx. If we scroll down, we can see the referrer here. So that's the referrer to the authentication bypass. Now, the funny thing is, it still shows 401 unauthorized. So even though this is a 401 unauthorized, it still, for some reason, got executed. So we don't actually grab any data from the page that we're accessing. This is the payload. So if I go to inspect, it's probably too small. But yeah, you can see this is the payload we're sending. You can see the code here. And if we scroll down, here's the actual compressed data table. So this is the actual payload, right? So this is the Base64 encoded gzipped exploit chain the Metasploit generated. And this is what will cause the SharePoint server over here to call back to my Kali box, right? Call back to Metasploit's listener and start deploying Meterpreter. And obviously, I have full disclosure, I turned off all antivirus scanning on this just to make the demo a little better. You'd hope that most of these environments would have antivirus or EDR solutions. But saying that, of course, you can bypass those. They're not that great. So there you go. This, honestly, though, setting up this SharePoint server took me a good 6 hours. And that was including, like, I had ChatGPT. I've never installed SharePoint before in my life. And ChatGPT, honestly, was quite a good help for this. But it was frustrating. And at multiple points, I just thought about giving up. And then the Metasploit payload came out, the Metasploit module. And I thought, I can't give up now because now I have something I can actually definitely test stuff on. And thankfully, you managed to get it working in, or at least in a sort of working state. Yeah, but crazy, really crazy vulnerability. And yeah, I'll leave all links to this Metasploit module, to the articles, to everything I've gone over in this video in the video description. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please consider giving it a like, subscribing to the channel, and leaving a comment with your thoughts. Until next time, happy hacking.